All right, welcome everybody to our Thursday night follow him evening. And we're going to be doing Psalms 1 to 46. And thanks to Carl for preparing and leading our discussion. And thanks to all of you that will view this, either participating with us tonight or review it recorded. And don't forget to express your like for it, to spread it out to others. Okay, turn the time over to you, Carl.
All right, thank you. Topics for this evening that I thought we'd deal with. Ancient musical instruments. I don't know anything about music really, and so it was quite an experience for me this week. The role of music in worship, samples of some ancient music, how the Psalms are organized, and then a temple reading of Psalms, or a way to integrate Psalms into a temple experience. So the actual word Psalms is from the Greek, which means instrumental music, or by extension, the words accompanying the music. And so that's why it's called Psalms from the Greek. And here are some ancient musical instruments. Now, some of them will be familiar to you. For example, the kinnor or the nebel, they were kind of like a lyre or a harp type instrument. The shofar, I think everybody is pretty familiar with the horn that was used both as music and in battle as signaling. The trumpet, I think, is pretty familiar. The bell. Yeah. Then there are kind of like cymbals and sort of flutes. The sistrum is kind of weird. Have you seen that before? It's actually of Egyptian origin, and it looks like they brought it from Egypt, and it shakes like a rattle. And so when you shake it, it makes kind of a rattle noise. And then there's something that appears to be like bagpipes, which was kind of freaking to me because I didn't think that anybody else had bagpipes, but the Scottish. But apparently it was a common instrument, particularly in the wartime, anciently, and it's been integrated into their music. And so because of this, I have to do a dad joke. When I grow up, I want to be just like you, but you can't. You're a different instrument. Are you calling me a liar? I don't know. I'm sorry. I have to throw it in. I've been waiting all year to use that one. Psalms, as we talked about on Sunday, was accumulated over 5 centuries from the time of David, from the time of the first kings, all the way down into the Babylonian captivity, which is about 500 years.
David was firstly a magician, musician, the sweet psalmist of Israel. As a youth, he practiced the harp on the sheep fields of Bethlehem. As a young man, he became a court musician for Israel's first king, Saul. But as he grew, he began to write down the inspired songs or psalms that he wrote, so that his own compositions fill nearly half the book of Psalms. But more than just a prolific lyricist and musician, David was a worshiper. His music wasn't just popular songs, it was worship. It comprised the intense emotions of struggle and the high freedom of praise and everything in between. Music gave voice to David's faith and his soul felt prayers.
This was a different flavor for me as I read through and studied some of this material, because I'm not a musician. I'm not very artistic at all. And I'm more a math and science guy. And so it's hard for me to understand David, who was a warrior, a king, and a musician, which to me seemed like sort of opposite traits. I don't know if that makes sense. But, you know, musicians are generally speaking, you know, more emotional, more soft-spoken, and you don't think of a warrior and a musician being the same person. That to me just seems a little bit of opposite, but he was this individual who was very obviously passionate. And why do you think he expressed so much in his music? Because you know that as you read through the scriptures, or at least as I read through the scriptures, it almost seems like God has a soft spot for David. Like he really, David is really praised, is very much a historic figure in Israel culture that is very larger than life, let's put it that way. And yet he made some of the most dramatic things happen, and he failed in some of the most dramatic ways. And so I think that he was very heartfelt. Like, a lot of his psalms are begging the Lord for mercy and for forgiveness. And so I find him a very interesting character.
Well, just thinking about your question, I mean, I think he was blessed with that talent. I've met musicians, because I'm not either, who, they always impress me about how they use music. I remember one fellow who's a missionary, and he would bear his testimony. Then he'd say, you know, I just need to go to the piano and bear my testimony through my music. And he would just play from the heart, nothing written. I don't know. It was beautiful. And
so, some people just have that talent, and that's how they express themselves.
It's amazing to us that don't. It's amazing to me. So David, it's like almost like David was like this, I guess.
Yep. Many of the Psalms are of a communal nature, so they invite participation from the whole congregation. As a hymn book, it was very appropriate for the whole congregation to recite the Psalms or to sing them and to know them. And we've already talked about them being used as scripture. We talked in depth on Sunday about that, how they prophesied of certain things, and because of the nature of putting music and words together, it was easy to memorize. It's an interesting method of understanding and knowing the scriptures. Now, I lean heavily on a couple of articles that I'm going to share with you, the information that I got from them. One of them is from the Interpretation Foundation, which is a Know Why. You've probably seen those in the Book of Mormon Central. They produce them quite frequently, and they get them from the same area. So this information, what was the role of music in ancient Israel? From the earliest times, music has played a central role in religion. The Book of Samuel is a great example. Before Saul became king, music enabled the Spirit of the Lord to come upon him in the company of prophets. Later, in Saul's misery, David's harp, or more accurately, lyre, invited the Spirit into his palace once more. Later, in the likeness of other nations in the ancient Near East, music and dance became an inseparable part of the institution of kingship in Israel. The Psalms, in a tradition that stretches back to David, contain some of the most significant prophecies of Scripture and become the backbone of temple worship.
The state needed a system for the training and management of musicians. Traditionally, the sacred musical groups were inaugurated by David to accompany the Ark's removal to Jerusalem, and were perpetuated in service before the tabernacle at its new home. The singers were divided into families by specific instruments. The major groups were strings, cymbals, and trumpets.
The temple used these specific musicians that were trained by the state, the government, the Kingdom of Israel, trained musicians to work in their temple. That would be an interesting temple calling, don't we think? Then I'm going to use another article from BYU, from their scholars archive, the ritual use of music in ancient Israelite worship. The Levites ministered before the Lord, offering up thanks and praise with instrument and voice. The Levites accompanied and aided worshipers in keeping divine commands to remember and offer thanksgiving to the Lord. Using their lyric text, the Psalms, the Israelites gathered in holy places and invoked the name of the Lord, literally requesting his presence. The Psalms accompanied ritual acts. A Levitical temple orchestra composed of lyres, harps, cymbals, and trumpets accompanied the daily sacrifices. And this was new to me, because I didn't have this image in my mind of them doing all of these daily sacrifices accompanied to music. I had always conjured in my memory the idea of them. It was almost like, and I know this doesn't quite fit, but it's almost like a butcher shop. I mean, they're killing animals and butchering them and then putting them on the altar and burning them. But apparently there was music going on this whole time in the background, with choirs singing and these particular instruments playing. And that was a new concept to me. I hadn't really heard of that before.
Well, I was gonna say it's new to me too, but it kind of makes sense to make it different than a butcher shop, to make it like the temple.
I guess it would be a natural way to cover some of the sounds which would otherwise be, I don't know, maybe less spiritual. I don't know how to describe that. I mean, well, I grew up some of the time on a farm. During the summer, we always visited the farm. And so we were there a lot. And so you get used to certain things, but you don't associate those things with the temple.
Sure. The ritual use of music in ancient Israel continued. Israelite worshipers sang songs of ascent as they would journey up to the house of the Lord. Music was a medium through which the Israelites were able to worship, expressing thanks and praise, as well as publicly announce the Lord's presence. Levites were charged with caring for the day-to-day requirements of temple service. This included the upkeep and preparation of instruments of the tabernacle and the temple. The musical instruments were considered vessels of service and therefore under the charge of the Levites.
And so as a group, as they're moving up to the temple, they're ascending to the hill of the Lord, and they could possibly be singing that particular song. Also, the Levites, in addition to their other duties that we've talked about in preparation and facilitating the sacrificing, they were also responsible for caring for and maintaining all of these instruments, which was also a new concept to me. I wanted you to hear a little bit of, you know, some of the ancient music, and so I'm borrowing some of these videos. Now, anciently, you can see how these horns, these shofar, were used in battle because they were loud and you could hear them. But they were also used in the temple ceremony. And I envision, particularly as they were ascending the hill of the Lord, they would have called the people using these horns, that they were very distinctive in their, well, they're called shofar blasts. There's also other instruments that I didn't necessarily mention. And one of them is this one here, which is a flute. And so we're going to listen to this Jewish musician, who's also a rabbi, who's going to explain a little bit about temple worship and about Psalm 30. And then he's going to play a tune which matches Psalm 30.
This melody can be sung to the Psalm number 30 that King David wrote, which King Solomon sang on the day of the dedication of the temple. When Solomon had finished the temple and built it, and all the people were there for the dedication, waiting for the divine presence, the glory of God to be revealed, the prayers were not answered. And Solomon prayed again, and all the people prayed, but the prayers were not answered, and the glory of God was not revealed. And then Solomon sang this psalm with the orchestra by his father, King David, saying that, please, God, with the merit of my father, King David, who wrote this psalm, this song, please let your glory shine forth from Jerusalem to all of the world.
Thank you.
I wish I could sing so that we could sing that music with these words. But after listening to it a few times, I was able to kind of follow the words with the rhythm of the music. And it makes for a very peaceful, inviting spirit that I think it's shared even today when, well, you know what it's like when you're listening to a particular music, that they invoke feelings. Music and words together are especially potent in doing so. There was a time when I was, because of certain circumstances, I was unable to attend church for about 9 months. And I remember that when I came back to my first church meeting, my first sacrament meeting, that I found the music, particularly the sacrament hymn, to be very moving for me on that day, because I had been outside of that experience for so long. And again, as I've talked about before, I'm not a very musical person, but I do find that music can influence even me, even a non-musical person, to a very, very great extent.
Church music, I mean, there's a reason we sing a sacrament hymn before we partake of the sacrament and hear the prayers, because, I mean, it does really help us to feel the Spirit.
It certainly worked for Saul when he was in a bad mood.
Well, you also think of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir in our general conference and in other events that they perform at, and the strength that they bring and the spirit that they bring to general conference.
Do you remember that there was that one podcast where the gentleman was talking about when he was on his mission and he went to visit somebody who was less active? And when he went there, he said he felt impressed to say, "Can we sing a hymn?" And when he did, when they sang this hymn, it melted the guy's heart. And even though he had been kind of less active and antagonistic somewhat towards the church for more than a decade, on hearing this song, it kind of changed his attitude. And then, of course, he came back and became active in the church. And then I remember another podcaster saying that they went to a particular very religious home, and they were not members of the church, and they asked them, "Can we sing a hymn?" And they said, "No, we've heard about your magic in singing hymns, so no, you're not allowed to, you can't sing. We're just here to debate." And I thought that was very interesting too.
But I've heard that said about the Book of Mormon. People that are anti church, they'll warn other people, like, "Oh, don't read that book because it'll affect you. It'll change your life."
That's a testament in itself. Okay, the Psalms of our Bible were originally used as the words of this ancient temple ceremony. Book of Mormon and early Christian drama, temple dramas, were similar. Hugh Nibley explained, "Early Christian worship revealed a constant concern to reproduce physically something as near as possible to the temple rites of Jerusalem. The bulk of worship is taken up with the Davidic Psalms, the old ritual texts of the temple. Many outstanding Bible scholars of the last century have observed that the festival drama was absolutely central to the religion of Israelites from at least the time of David and Solomon until 587 BC, when Jerusalem was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar and its inhabitants transported to Babylon. After the Jerusalem temple was demolished by the Babylonians, the full drama was no longer performed by the Jews as part of the Law of Moses ordinances. The oldest writing that we have of an ancient temple drama is from Egypt. And we have hieroglyphs that talk about this drama that they had when they were dedicating temples or when they were having significant religious ceremonies. Not to say that they originated in Egypt, but that's the oldest writing that we have of it. From Hugh Nibley, we have the concept that the existence of this temple drama has long been recognized. It is vividly set forth in ancient Egyptian theology, which makes it clear that the drama was already very old when it was performed to celebrate the dedication of the temple and the founding of the first dynasty in Egypt. It spread from there to Greece. So you think of all these Greek plays that we have, they are part of or spin-offs from this temple drama. It spread from there to Greece, where we have a collection of tragedies dealing with the subjects of good and evil in terms of power and gain. Not only Greece, however, but the rest of the world sooner or later adapted the same temple drama, the same standard temple drama. It should be noted that this drama is in its oldest and purest form was not meant to be a spectacle. It wasn't for entertainment, but it was an instructive demonstration. The theme is fully developed through the ancient world in all its detail. It should be noted that the purpose of its participation of mankind in rites and in seeking the assurance of resurrection. So the whole idea behind these dramas was to instruct people and to educate them as to what God wanted and how it was possible to return and be resurrected. And so when you see the classical plays that are very ancient, that was originally the purpose behind it. And that was a new concept for me. Now, if I use the term divine counsel, do you understand what that is, or have you heard that before? You see it most often in the Old Testament and sometimes in the Book of Mormon. When prophets receive a calling, they have a dream where they're in front of God and a divine counsel, and they're given their kind of instructions. And so this is replete throughout all of ancient history. They talk about the divine counsel. It becomes part of this temple drama. The Feast of the Tabernacles, or the ancient temple drama, was an experience that helped groups of Israelites to experience what it was like for prophets to be called of God to do his work. The presentation of the prophet before the heavenly council, or this divine council, was something that has an extensive background throughout the ancient Near East. The ancient temple drama was kind of a generic version of the sod, and that's the Hebrew word they use for the temple experience, that Israelite prophets experienced anciently. And also Lehi, he had this same experience. This drama, also called the Festival of Yahweh, was held in autumn at Jerusalem and was called by the king of Israel. So the king announced the time when everybody would come to this festival. The festival drama was an invitation not to, just to Israel, but also all nations, as all were considered under the sovereign power and authority of Yahweh. The events celebrated were the sojourning of the children of Israel in the wilderness and the gathering in of all the fruits of the year. The ancient Israelite temple drama taught each individual participant that the significance of the premortal covenants each had made before he came to earth is relevant to one's present earthly responsibility and to one's ultimate salvation, as the covenants of God made with the prophets when these prophets communed with God in the divine council. So they're emphasizing the idea that we made promises before we came to earth, and that we're here to not only fulfill the covenants that we're making now, but the ones that we made before, that when we were part of the divine council. In other words, individuals participating in the ancient temple drama were to see their making of covenants as relevant to their salvation and their sphere of influence as the covenants made by the prophets and the kings in the drama itself. So the drama is really about the king, but the king is a representation for each of us individually. The king and the queen were representations of what we were also undertaking. As also integral in this festival was the importance of understanding the idea that the king and queen were representatives of God on earth, and there was a need for religious and political order, and that through covenant, all Israel could be tied to God and live in peace, living in a state referred to as prospering in the land. And so that term, prospering in the land, should be very, very familiar because of the Book of Mormon, right? If you keep the commandments, you will prosper in the land. But it was also a part of this temple drama that was participated in by everybody over a period of time. It was like 8 days. Well, I'll show you the next slide.
The drama lasted 8 days and was divided into three major segments, like three acts of a play with multiple scenes. The three acts were the premortal experience, this world, and promises of the world to come. The drama of the festivals is obvious through a close examination of the Psalms. The story of Yahweh's ark and David is portrayed. Danger is portrayed, where our heroes experience an outbreak of the forces of chaos, with the king crying out for God's help. The wicked forces are put down. Speech is launched from different quarters. A group speaks. The king addresses the rebels. God addresses his king. A priest speaks blessings and prayers over the king. One point of the festival drama that is important is that God has chosen his king and anointed him to represent him on earth, allowing him to be tested through the trials of the enemies of God, after which the hero king will be raised up as a son of God. This entire drama focused on the redemptive power of the God Yahweh and his ability to literally make all of Israel kings and queens.
I thought that was really intriguing, especially as you consider the temple ceremony as we go through today. This drama lasted for 8 days, and the whole purpose behind it was to teach the people that they could eventually become kings and queens. And I thought that was very intriguing, particularly, you know, imagine going to the temple and experiencing the temple over an 8-day period. But of course, with travel restrictions, et cetera, back in the day when they all came together, of course, they only had the opportunity maybe once a year to go to the temple. And so they got their full week's worth. They got this temple drama, this temple education completed for them. But it was done on an annual basis. Like it said here, it was like a 3-act play, but over a week's period of time in which the people were educated as far as the spirit world, what we're doing now, what will happen afterwards. And it was all done through the example of the king, who is the major player, but with the underlying current that we all could become kings and queens and that we all participated in these covenants.
It's interesting that there is a focus on the premortal existence or experience, even though it's not well accepted as doctrine outside of our church.
But was systematically removed. After the Babylonian captivity, there was a lot of editing done.
Yes.
Because things didn't quite work anymore because there was no temple. So all of a sudden, 2/3 of what you know in the law of Moses is no longer relevant because there's no temple. And so they made some major modifications to allow for that. And so that when the temple did resume function, was reconstituted, reconstructed, and they had a temple, they left some stuff out. Okay, so I guess what I learned this week from Psalms is that the Psalms invites us to become more Christ-like. You feel the pleading, the group pleading, the group praising. It invites us to become more Christ-like, and becoming Christ-like then moves us closer to the temple. And then as we attend the temple, it helps us to be more Christ-like. And so there's this cycle that continues that began with Psalms and with singing and with praising and with music that draws us closer to Jesus Christ, which then the cycle continues. And it's part of this process that we go through for our refining. And that's not something that I ever really considered before. And so I was really grateful to view it in that light this week. And so that's what I learned. And so I will turn it back to you, Rod.
Well, thanks, Carl. Thanks for your insights. Yeah, this has been very helpful.